Welcome to Holmes and Watson world of induction, where data is the key to truth production. In hypothesis testing, they will show you the way. When p-value is low, the null's not here to stay. Join the adventure. Don't let this chance slip as they unravel the secrets with a data-driven grip. Sherlock, I'm not feeling well and I suspect it might be due to something I ate. My theory is that the nearby pizza shop sells poisonous food, but I can't prove it. Would you mind helping? Watson, sorry to hear that. But jumping to conclusions without evidence won't get us far. Moreover, I'd prefer not to use the word prove here. In data science, we can't prove things in the same manner as mathematicians do. Instead, we gather data and evidence and conduct experiments to either support or challenge our theories. Tomatoes, would you help or not? Of course, my dear Watson. Sherlock just highlighted the first principle that any data scientist should keep in mind when approaching hypothesis testing. Data cannot definitely prove anything, but it can provide evidence for or against a hypothesis. To establish that the pizza shop is selling poisonous food, the burden of finding evidence to support your claim falls upon you. Sherlock just emphasizes the second principle of hypothesis testing. The burden of proof rests with those making the positive claims. For example, Watson can't ask the pizza shop to prove that their food is not poisonous. The responsibility of finding evidence is on Watson. You always need to start from the status quo and challenge it. Wait, what do you mean by challenging the status quo? The scientific method is all about challenging the current understanding, the default, or the norm. In our context, the status quo represents the assumption that the food from the pizza shop is safe, unless our gathered data suggest otherwise. And this brings us to the third principle of hypothesis testing. To be scientific, we need to begin by challenging the default, the status quo using data. In our case, this default is that all food from the pizza shop is not poisonous and safe to consume. This default is known as the null hypothesis, denoted as H note. By the way, the positive claim, what you want to prove, and in our case is that the food from the pizza shop is poisonous, is known as the alternative hypothesis and denoted as HA. If you find this challenging to grasp, consider this in the same light as the legal principle, innocence until proven guilty. The status quo is that the person is innocent, which is the null hypothesis, and the alternative hypothesis is that they are guilty. Nobody is asked to prove that a person is innocent, and instead, the burden is on the prosecution to prove guilty. And now for the best part, data gathering. Let's order food from the pizza shop. Our data should be representative and the sample size is adequate. So I will order 10 meals. Who's paying for this? Of course it's on you. I ordered some dessert too. While the sample could have been more representative, sample size matters in hypothesis testing. Smaller sample may lead to less reliable results, and large samples can provide more robust evidence. But let's go for 10 now, as it serves for illustration purposes. Now we are going to test in the lab every meal in our sample. The first meal is clean, the second meal is clean, the third meal is not clean. Gotcha. Easy, Watson. You can't jump to conclusion based on just one data point. We need to test all the meals from the sample. Then we ask ourselves this question. Let's assume that the null hypothesis, the status quo, is true, meaning that the food from the pizza shop is safe to consume. What is the probability of obtaining this result from the sample? So if the majority of the meals were poisonous, we need to ask what is the probability of obtaining such results that the majority of the meals are infected from the sample if we believe that the null hypothesis is true, that the pizza shop sells safe food. If the null hypothesis is correct, that the shop sells clean food, it's very unlikely to end up with such results, like the majority of the sample is infected. The sample result is inconsistent with the status quo, and we can reject the null hypothesis, rejecting the status quo. And if, say, one meal is found poisonous in our sample, in that case it's more likely to get such results, assuming the status quo, the null hypothesis, is true, and we wouldn't have enough evidence to reject the status quo, to reject the null hypothesis. But Sherlock, what is the threshold for this probability? I mean, how low is low enough to be confident that the null hypothesis is unlikely to be true? Fantastic question. Usually, if this probability is less than 5%, then it's considered to be low enough. When this happens, the result is said to be statistically significant. Just to elaborate here, it's essential to clarify that the choice of the significance level, the 5%, is arbitrary and can vary depending on the context and field of study. Lower threshold, like 1%, may be used for more strict criteria. The researchers should justify their chosen significance level based on the specific circumstances. So if it's statistically significant, can we reject the null hypothesis in favor of the alternative hypothesis? Meaning, can we reject that the shop sells clean food? Yes, we can. But note that if we get results of more than 5%, then the null hypothesis is retained. This doesn't necessarily mean that we accept the null hypothesis as true. It simply means that there isn't currently enough evidence to conclude that it's false. Researchers often use the phrase fail to reject the null hypothesis rather than retain the null hypothesis. They never use the phrase accept the null hypothesis, though. Going back to our jurisdictional example, if the prosecution lacks strong evidence that the defendant committed a crime, the defendant is just as not guilty rather than innocent. Similarly, a statistical test can't prove the null hypothesis, but can provide evidence against it. This probability is referred to as the p-value. And a wise man once said, when the p-value is low, the null hypothesis must go. It's important to note that there are dedicated statistical tests for calculating the p-value, but they are beyond the scope of this video, perhaps in a future video. So, now the moment of the truth. What is the result we got from the samples? Well, my friend, we got a probability of 30%. Not low enough to reject the null hypothesis, I'm afraid. Actually, it means that if the food in this restaurant is safe, the probability of getting this result from the sample is 30%. As I mentioned before, this 30% is a result of dedicated statistical tests that they are out of the scope of this video. If you are interested in such statistical tests, please leave a comment your favorite statistical test so I cover it in the next video. Oh no, it must have been something else. The good thing that I have tons of free food to enjoy. You didn't know that this would be the case before we ordered, did you? Of course I did, but I thought a costly lesson for you wouldn't hurt much. I hope you now understand the hypothesis testing. If you like this content, please like, share, and subscribe. And see you next time.